we thank you that you will establish us and secure us in safety and in joy, in laughter and in love, and in strength and in dunamis power. And we give your name glory and honor in this place. In Jesus' name, amen. And if you could stand all over to your feet. Stand on your feet all over in this room. I know we've had a hard day at work, but we're going to press into his presence. We are going to press into the holies of holies because he is worthy of it all in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah. We bless your name. Come on, let's clap our hands as we begin to prepare for worship. Father, we adore you. We bless you. Hallelujah, Jesus. Come on, everybody, put your hands together.
Hallelujah.
We have come into this house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship Christ our Lord. Worship him, Christ the Lord. Come on, say, we have. Gathered in his name to worship him. Say,
we have come.
Gathered in his name to worship him. Yes, Lord, say,
we have.
We're gathered in his name to worship him. Say, worship him. Worship him. Sing,
we have come.
We're gathered in his name to worship him. Sing,
we have come.
And we're gathered in his name to worship. Sing, worship him. Sing, Christ. Lord. So forget about yourself,
yeah,
and consecrate on him and worship him. So forget about yourself and concentrate on him and worship him. So forget about yourself and concentrate on him and worship Christ our Lord. Worship him, Christ our Lord. Come on,
so forget about yourself
and concentrate
on him
and worship him.
So forget about yourself
and concentrate
and worship him.
Hallelujah.
So forget about yourself
and concentrate
and
worship him.
So forget about yourself and concentrate and worship him.
So forget about yourself and concentrate and worship him. Our Lord. Sing
worship.
Come on, we want to bless your name, Jesus. Sing worship him. We come to give your name the glory. Sing
worship him.
We want to give your name all of the honor and all of the praise.
begin to worship his name. Hallelujah, we bless your name, Jesus. We glorify your name, oh God. Hey, we bless your name, Jesus. Hey, say you worship him.
Worship him.
We want to give you all the glory.
Worship him.
We've come to give your name all of the praise.
Worship him.
We want to come to bless your name.
Worship him.
Hey, we want you to worship him.
Worship him.
Worship him.
Worship
him. We want to give your name the glory. We want to give your name the praise. We come to worship. Sing worship him. Oh, sing
worship.
Christ the Lord.
I know that we are tired. It's been a week. We're at the end of it. But thank you for your press. But we got to give God something to work with. Hallelujah. So praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. I am here to give, to let people testify today. I'm excited about that because the word says they overcame by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. You have to tell what God did for you. You can't keep it a secret. You have to let everyone know so that they can believe in your risen Savior. Is there anybody that has a testimony? If you don't have a
I've been moving out my office for like the past week and a half. And it was crazy because they was like, man, you did good in this building. You brought it back up to par where it's supposed to be. And hopefully the next guy don't make it fail because that's on him. But it's on them. So they end up moving me out and they end up moving me to another building. But instead of one building now, they was like, we're going to give you three buildings. So now I'm managing three buildings, and the crazy part is Monday I came into another site, and I end up walking out to my car for something, probably to play a game on my phone or something like that, something stupid. And I ran into my building chief, and he was like, hey, come here for a minute, I need you to step into the office. So I was like, oh my goodness, like, did I do something? And we got in the office, and he was asking me questions about, you know, electrical issues, and I was like, you know, I told him the truth. I was like, HVAC ain't my thing. And he was like, don't worry about it because I'm about to send you to school for that, and we're going to pay for it. And I was like, all right, that's what's up. So then, like, I end up answering some more questions for him about plumbing and electrical issues. And then he was like, you know what? That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to end up putting you in for a promotion. Because he was like, you went from one building to another building, and now we're giving you three buildings, like you've been doing your thing. So I'm like, well, you know, I am me, you know. But I danced on my way all the way out to the car for real. People probably was looking at me on that site like I was crazy, but, you know, all honor go to God for real, because, you know, without him, ain't none of this possible, honestly. And that's my testimony. Like, I'm about to get a promotion, y'all.
Let's pray, Elder.
Hey, speaking of promotion, first I want to give honor to God. One, God know I'm wacky, but I want to thank God for revelation and for speaking in like the most unique ways to me. I'm speaking up for promotion. I have an interview for a position that I put in an application for. My boss's position, she retired, and so I have an interview on Tuesday for it. But on the way there, I bless God for the scripture that Minister Candace sent me when I was telling her about how nervous I was, and it was about how God promotes you, worrying, you know, thinking about how he has the power over male, over man. But the thing that was getting me, like all today, I kept running into people that retired from my job or left, and they remembered me from when I first started 15 years ago. They started sharing stories about how they remember when I used to take the bus and all of that. But the thing that got me, I sat in a car, and I thanked the Lord for the opportunity to go down memory lane. And each memory from years and years and years and years ago, God's handprint was on each and every one. So my testimony is, God, I thank you for the opportunity to not just remember pain, to not just remember the hardships, to not just remember or think about the situation that I may be in, but that I could remember that his hand has been in each and every moment. So much so that people that left a long time ago remembered too. They remembered the Jesus that I talked about. They remembered the Jesus that still is alive today. So I pray that my testimony is your testimony, that out of everything you've been through, that everything you're going through, that out of everything you may remember, that you also remember that Jesus was there too.
Hey, praise the Lord, everybody. So I'm going to read this scripture from the Message Bible, and it says, be easy on people, you'll find life a lot easier. Give away your life, you'll find life given back, but not merely given back with bonus and blessing. Giving, not getting, is the way. Generosity begets generosity. And I can't even tell you, I've been talking about my car that I was able to get on Saturday, but I just want to give a little backstory. So last August, I lost my car. I walked outside, I thought somebody had towed it, but my car was gone. And as many know, I was in chemo last year. So last year was a really big struggle for me. It was either like we was going to eat, we going to have a roof, or we going to have a car. And so I had to make hard decisions last year, and it wasn't the decisions I want, but I trusted God even in this. And I'm not necessarily a complainer. I keep things to myself a lot. And last year I really went through. It was really tough for me. And so I began to rely on God, and God was just like, rely on the things that I gave you. You may not have money, but you have other things. And so I had been giving out of myself for a while now. And at one point I was like, God, you forgot about us. Like, we're riding, we're asking for rides. And sometimes if you don't have a car, you know it gets tiring. People don't always want to pick you up, and it's a humbling experience. And so this year, God humbled me more. He humbled me even more to be a servant and to be okay in everything that you do. You still give. And so I asked God this year for discipline in my giving so that I can get on track just in life. And so I began to work on my finances, work on things. And that stuff is hard when you got to look at your bank account like, dang, this is what I've been spending. This is what. So I really have been working. So I knew that my job was going to give us a bonus this year. And so I was like, hey, I'm going to go ahead and give my bonus for a car. Unbeknownst to me, my bonus was like $3,100 and some change. And so I went to the car dealership last Saturday, and she was like, we're going to try to find you something. And so at first I felt myself getting like discouraged, because I'm like, this is crazy. I literally had to wait 7 days for me to wake up, and she said, I have a car for you. I have another car for you, because the one that she wanted to give me was gone. The thing about this newer car, it had less miles on it. It was a newer version, and my payments were lower. And so God literally provided for Marco. I was able to give
the check, the bonus that I got. And even last year, not last year, in January, Pastor told us to get the 224. Y'all was trembling. I was like, I was trembling. I was like, all right, Lord, I'm going to give my tithes and I'm going to give this 224. Within that 2 weeks of me giving the 224, God had like quadrupled it with my business. Then I was able to give the money to give the deposit for my vehicle. And Marco is still not lacking anything. I'm still making money off of my business. And I say that to say, use your gifts and your talents that God has given you. Be generous in whatever that you do. Don't complain. If you see somebody needs something, give it. Give out of what you have. It doesn't always have to be money. And God will bless you. And I literally am walking. Literally, every time I get in the car, and Elder Javonte texts me, say, every time I see that message, she is driving. She'll get back to you later. I get filled up because I am driving. I'm no longer walking. I'm able to get to and fro, and I'm able to actually bless people, to give people a ride. So I say that to say, be generous this year. Be disciplined in your giving. Pay your tithes. Give your offering. Like Pastor said a couple of days ago, it doesn't matter what you give. At times, I didn't have nothing to give but $5, but I gave it believing, and he's never left me. He's never forsaken me. I've always had. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. First and foremost, I'm just glad to be at church. It's been a while. My testimony is a scripture. Everybody knows this. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. It's only February 8th. And it's been a year already, and I just came through a year, and God is continually reminding me that he's got me covered on top and underneath and on my side and on this side and in front of me and behind me. And the last couple of weeks, I felt so alone. And I remember last year, Pastor Lee said, she kept telling me, you're not alone, you're not alone, you're not alone. And the last couple of weeks, I was home by myself. It was me and Zaria, and I was sick, and I felt alone, and everybody showed up. I got text messages. I got phone calls. I got messages on band. Everybody showed up, and when I felt so alone, God reminded me of that simple thing. You are not alone.
Praise the Lord. God is just so intricate in what he does. I was going to read the very scripture she read, but it was, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. 2023 was a rough year, but God was faithful. I was doing my numbers from last year. Minister Latika sent the giving report for what I gave last year, and it was a big difference. It was less than what I gave the year before. And then when I did my numbers are a lot less. But in the midst of it being less, God made me debt free. It's like when I say I was doing the numbers and I was like, oh my gosh, it's like almost 15,000 less. And it's like, but he provided everything I needed. I mean, everything. And so when I thought about, even though David said, I walked through the valley of the shadow of death this morning in my quiet time, the Lord was like, I'm with you. He said, but the difference is in the new covenant, I'm inside of you, I'm within you. So he surrounds us. And then he says, now I live in you. I'm the hope of glory. And so he was like, so not all of you, not alone. I'm literally carrying you through. So he said to me this morning, he said, it's a blessing. I'm trying to get you, and he said my people in general, to be okay with the in-between. It's something about the in-between. We want to rush through it, and we're like, God, deliver. We feel like we're waiting on the praise break for the deliverance, but he says, I'm in there with you. And, you know, I thought about the Hebrew boys. He was in there with them. And so now he's on the inside of me. So regardless of what it looks like, I'm going to be okay because he's within me. And I can make it, and I can go through. And I was like, God, how did I become debt free, making far less? So my only expenses are my monthly expenses. You couldn't have never told me that would happen. I've been praying for that for a long time, but it materialized in a hard season. So don't worry about the hard seasons. God is in the hard seasons. God bless you all.
Hi, church. So, as many of you guys know, I used to be in the military, and one of the benefits of being in the military is you get your school paid for. And so, this is my last semester of nursing school. I graduated on May 11th. So, every semester I usually get a stipend. And so, I submitted my paperwork to the VA to go to New York and all of that stuff, like usual. But this time, the VA came back and said, we can only pay for two of your classes. The other four seem like electives. I was like, well, nothing in nursing is an elective. So it's all core. And so anyways, that stopped my money from coming. So I only got a fifth of what is entitled to me. So therefore, my bills couldn't get paid. When I say nothing could get paid, nothing. And there was also consecration during that time too. So I'm sitting there consecrating, literally watching people get blessed and all types of stuff. I'm like, Lord, okay. And they're like, many people know that I'm an extremely quiet person. I could literally be going through something, but I will sit over there and smile. Nobody really knows unless you really know me. And so one of the people that really knows me is Minister Candace. I will call her, and we'll be on the phone for 2 hours, and she'll pull me back off a ledge, or Elder Lakeisha, somebody. And so they just kept saying, just keep waiting. And I'm like, the Lord can take a lot of things from me, but one thing I pride myself is like financial security. At least I got me. This season he stripped me of even me. I couldn't do nothing. I just had to sit and just... Like, it was like, but the Lord gave me favor with all my creditors. They pushed them out, and even my car note was due on January 23rd. He pushed that out. And then on January 31st, I was getting ready to take a shower and threw a whole temper tantrum. I was like, I went through every scripture known to man in my heart, trying to ask the Lord, when is this going to happen? And so I was like, and then I was going to send it wasn't a nasty email, but it was like a partially sarcastic email to the person that was over my stuff. I was like, so I'm going to be homeless tomorrow? Like, I was going to say something real weird. But then I was like, someone's like, don't send it. I was like, all right, I'll send it tomorrow. And so after my temper tantrum, I went to sleep. Because what else am I going to do? I forgot who told me, it's like, either you're going to trust the Lord or you're not. So I was like, okay. You gonna trust the Lord or you not? So I was like, all right, Lord, I'm gonna trust you. Scared, I don't know what's going on. I could be homeless next week. I could have repossession on my credit next week. I don't know. And so January 31st, I ain't send the email. And then I like woke up from the VA. They was like, go ahead and send your stuff. Your stuff has been processed. Just submit your stuff. You're good. So I went ahead and submitted it. And then the very next day, I won like an emergency scholarship. So that's coming. So like that's coming in the mail. And then it was like the pieces and the fragments, I would get a little bit here, I would get a little bit there. Still ain't got all of it, but it's still coming. That emergency is coming. And then finally, the VA paid my tuition, so my FAFSA is now in the student office. It's coming to me too. And so, you know, all of that's happening. And I was still asking, I even asked Ella Lakeisha, what's that for? She was like, no, it was Minister Candace, but both of them said it. God was stretching you. He was stretching your faith. He was like, you can even trust me in this. So through all of my screaming, I trusted him in this. And now I have history with the Lord, and that when or if anything else comes up, I at least know that the Lord got it.
God bless you. May be seated, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. You may be seated all over the house. We thank God for you, you and you in the house today. And we are grateful for the work of the Lord. Jordy's ready to receive our children tonight. Come on, clap your hands for our children's ministry. Now, if y'all not the one teaching, you ought to clap the one teaching. Amen. Thank God for our children's ministry. To all of our children, amen, you can come to the front to receive your teacher tonight. Ms. Jordan, we thank God for you and all the children. I'm going to ask you what you learned, and so make sure that you learn something good tonight. Amen. The Lord will bless you and keep you in perfect peace as you keep your mind stayed on Him. Restoration Church, you were looking at the next Restoration Church. Come on, somebody. You ought to give God praise for them. One day we'll be sitting down and they'll be up here preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. Amen. How do I know that? Because we were once them. Amen. I remember my children's classes and my children's ministry, and now I'm standing up here. Now we have a responsibility, amen, to teach the next generation, and we are grateful for each and every one of you here today. Amen. Our first lady's watching tonight. Would you give God praise for her and let her know that we love her? And to everyone in the room, we thank God. Amen. Just point to somebody and say, I'm glad that you're here tonight. Amen. Point to somebody you haven't seen yet. Tell them I'm glad that you're here tonight. Amen. My testimony tonight is really about the unity and fellowship of this church. I love seeing new relationships. I love seeing people get to learn different ones. Some of you are sitting next to people that you didn't know this time last year. And it's a blessing. This may not mean nothing to you, but Carrie walked in. Carrie, raise your hand, Carrie. She walked in, and this is not nothing to y'all, but it's something to me. She walked in, and Daisha, who's ushering today, led her to her seat. To my knowledge, Carrie didn't know Chloe, right? Y'all didn't know each other before Restoration Church. And she came in and sat in her seat and reached over and hugged her, and they embraced. And I just sat there just like, Lord, thank you for this. Thank you that we are not territorial. Thank you that we are not cliquish. Thank you that we understand that we have brothers and sisters who don't carry our last name. Y'all don't feel that? I felt something in that. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. God wants us to have healthy kingdom relationships. And all of your relationships and all of your strength does not come from those who carry the same blood as you. Amen. Amen. That's why you never hear me say it. And if you believe it, say it for you. Say it for you. I don't say family over everything, because I want in my life who God wants in my life. Amen. Y'all don't have to agree, but I want in my life who God, this is why Jesus said, who is my mother? Who is my father? My family are those that do the will of my father. Amen. And sometimes people who don't carry your blood got your blessing. Amen, somebody. They may not have your blood, but they do have your destiny in their mouth. Amen. And so God will oftentimes connect people through kingdom relationships. And you never know, because God can change your entire life by somebody who you don't know. So when you come to church, amen, take a moment to greet people, love on people, because you never know when they need you, and you never know when you will need them. And so my testimony tonight is that we have a church who loves fellowship. and a church who loves each other. Amen. And we'll sit next to anybody. Amen. 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 That's also an encouragement to you all that when the ushers sit next to somebody you don't know, maybe the Lord is trying to connect you to somebody else. Well, I don't want to sit here. You should sit there because they might have your miracle right where they are. Amen. And so don't be afraid of new relationships and meeting new people. And no, you don't have to be an extrovert to meet new people. Amen. You can be an introvert. You might be sitting next to an introvert and y'all going to get through this together. Amen. When pastor says touch your neighbor 18 times and y'all just like, all right. And you sit next to another introvert. Amen. Amen. So get to know new people when you come to church. Amen. I encourage you when you come to church, find somebody to connect with. This is why we have life groups, right? Amen. Amen. How many of y'all love your life group? That's who you do life with. That's who you do life with. And every time we get to December, people say, Pastor, do we have to switch? Yes. Because every year we want you to get to know somebody else. Amen. And so we are grateful to each and every one of you. Father, we are just so grateful for your presence in this house today. Lord, just grateful for you being here tonight. Sometimes you move through the fire, and sometimes you move through the volume and the dynamics of a church, and sometimes you move through the whisper. And tonight, Lord, we just thank you that we feel your love in this room. We are just so grateful that you love us, that you care for us, and we say thank you. We don't have to be dancing and shouting to say thank you. We thank you because you have been good to us. For the food that we have eaten today, for the house that we live in, for the car that we drive, we say thank you. And yes, Lord, I know that things can be better, but tonight we thank you because things can also be worse. And so, Lord, we will not use this opportunity to complain. We use this opportunity to give your name all the glory, the honor, and the praise. Now, God, as we go into your word tonight, I pray that you feed us. Bread of heaven, feed us until we want no more. And let this word go down deep in our spirit until we are restored, renewed, and revived by the power of the Holy Ghost. We say all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Say amen one more time. I'm excited about the word of God tonight. As you can see, I'm wearing my Philadelphia hoodie. I was in Philly yesterday just preparing for what God is getting ready to do next in Philadelphia. And I'm excited. Amen. How many of y'all excited about Philly? Amen. We are working hard for our relaunch in May. And we have some great events coming up. And I wore this in Philly today. I was going to get changed. I said, no, I'm going to go ahead and represent them all day today because they are a part of us. Amen? Amen. So we are grateful for what the Lord is going to do. We have been, last week Thursday, I started teaching on our theme for the year, which is A3, which is alignment, assignment, and assessment. Everyone say that with me. Alignment. One more time. Alignment, assignment, and assessment. This is a year that I believe that God is trying to get us. I hope I can say this without you in a way that you can understand. I really do believe that God is aligning us this year to get us ready for next year. There are some reaping years, and there are some sowing years. And I believe this is a sowing year. This is our year to contribute. This is our year to invest. Even when you hear Minister LaTanya talking about being generous, whenever God says to you to give more, to sow more, to do more, to serve more, it's because God is trying to prepare you for an harvest that's coming. Amen. Now, that's not just money. That's in service also, whether you're on the metro, whether someone just needs a hug, someone just needs to hear a word of encouragement. Whenever God is calling you to do more, it's because God is aware of something that you're not aware of. Amen. Because he knows the end before the beginning. And so God, in his wisdom and in his strength, is able to see further than we can. And I truly do believe that God has got us in a preparing season. We are preparing for what we're getting ready to see at Restoration Church. And dare I say to you, Restoration Church, that God, we really don't want God to bless an unprepared church. Not just the church. We don't want God to bless an unprepared us. Amen. I truly believe that as much as I believe God is going to increase me financially, that I don't want God to increase me if I don't know how to handle my current money well. Because I will squander what I ought to be blessing people with. And so God has to leave me on my current level until I am prepared for the next level. Amen. It's not just money. It could be about a church too. There are some people who feel that they are ready for elevation. And God is saying, well, you're not ready because your prayer life doesn't match what you want. Amen. Sometimes people think they're ready for things, but the truth be told, Restoration Church with higher positions come more responsibility. If you don't like people talking about you, don't get elevated. If you don't like lies being told about you, don't get elevated. If every time you see somebody's post on Facebook it bothers you, don't even seek elevation. Because the higher up you go, the more of a target you become. And that's not a church thing. That was a Jesus thing. They talked about him too. And so what God is trying to do in this season is get us aligned with him. Everybody say alignment. I want to share just a few more things with you that I think is important in addition to last week as it pertains to alignment, which I think is extremely important. Everyone, one more time, shout alignment. While I'm sharing some of these things, I want you to go to 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. Media, if you can, and I want to start. I want to start a little earlier than I would. 1 Corinthians chapter number 12. Go there and let's begin at verse number 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse number 12. While you're doing that, for those who are making notes, I want you to write this down. That if you're going to walk in alignment, and this is in addition to last week, alignment means that there must be unity. Everyone say unity. Unity. Say it again. Say unity. Unity. And the definition of a unity is that we must have a common purpose. Not just an individual purpose, but everyone say common purpose. What do we want together? The question becomes, Restoration Church, why did you come to church tonight? What is our common purpose? Now, I can give this mic to anybody in this room and they would tell me what their individual purpose is. I came because I want to grow in the Word of God. I came because I want to fellowship with people. I came because I have nothing to do on a Thursday night. I came because it's Thursday night. I came because coming to church keeps me out of trouble. Everyone has individual reasons. Amen. Amen. Everyone has individual reasons why they come to church. But the question then becomes, what is our common purpose? What is the thing that we agree on together? Because if there's nothing, the Bible says in Amos chapter 3 and verse 3, how can two walk together except they have agreed with a D? That means it's past tense. We have to agree before we walk. We don't agree as we walk. We must agree and then we walk. How can two walk together without a already shared agreement? And if we ever get to a place, hallelujah, where we all agree on the same thing, can you imagine how incredible service will be on Sunday if all of us have the same purpose to win souls? Oh, no. I don't talk. Well, I want to hear pastor preach. I want to hear the choir sing. If everyone came with one common purpose for somebody's soul to be saved, we would flip this church upside down. The reason why sometimes we're not where we should be, we think it's because of leadership, or we think it's because of the building, or we think because this or that. Sometimes we just don't have unity in the room. Everyone comes with their own agenda. Everyone comes wanting something. Everybody wants to eat, but nobody wants to feed. Everybody wants to be served, but nobody wants to serve. When is the last time you came to church and sat in your seat and said, Lord, use me? Or do you pray, Lord, use my pastor? We don't recognize that God wants to use us right on the road that we are on. You are closer to your neighbor than your pastor. Y'all missed it. You are closer to your neighbor than your pastor. So sometimes if pastor says, touch your neighbor, oh, he's saying touch your neighbor a lot. But what if God is trying to use you to get a message to the person sitting next to you? What if the usher didn't place you there? What if God strategically placed you next to the person you're sitting next to? Because they're suicidal and you have been through it. But because you don't want to talk to nobody, because I don't do people. Amen. Come on, we're talking about alignment now. Amen. I don't do people, but you want God to take care of you. What if God wants to use you? God never blesses you for you. He blesses you to use you. He blesses you to get a message through you. It's never just to you. It's always through you. So the question is, even here tonight on a Bible study night, what is our common purpose? We come on Sunday. What is our common, what do we want together? Do we want, and here's the thing. The common purpose, thank you, Holy Ghost, should not just be something that we all agree upon. The common purpose should be something that we agree on as it pertains to what heaven wants for our church. The church ought to agree with heaven, but the church can't agree with heaven until the church gets on the same page. Whew. Good God Almighty. Are y'all with me tonight? Everyone shout it. Say alignment. And shout common purpose. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on alignment this week because we did alignment and some assignment last week. We will spend most of our time on assessment tonight. But let me just set this up. 1 Corinthians chapter 12 and verse number 12. I'll read it and you can follow along on the screen. It says, "For as the body is one and has many members, but all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ." Verse number 13. "For by one spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit." Verse 14. "For in fact, the body is not one member, but many members." Verse 15. "If the foot should say to the say, because I am not a hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? And if the ear should say, because I am not an eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body?" I'm getting to where I want to be. "If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling?" Now that might seem strange to you all, but I want you to know that happens in church all the time. If everybody wants to be a leader, who follows? If everybody wants to sing, who do we sing to? I gave the analogy last week of the fact that all four of our musicians, Zion, Khalil, Chauncey, and Deacon Curtis, all of them can play a measure of the keyboard. Some can play better than others, but all of them can play, all of them know how to play to a degree, right? Can you imagine if you came in on Sunday and all four musicians were at the keyboard with Zion fighting to play the keyboard? That's how we look in church sometimes. Everybody's trying to do the same thing. But the reason why the band works well is because everybody is gifted, but everybody knows their place. I need you to ask somebody, say, do you know your place? Mm-hmm. Because just because you can doesn't mean that you should. Good God Almighty. One more time, son. Just because you can doesn't mean that you should. Well, I'm gifted in this area, but are you called to it? I can do this in your last church. What does God ask you to do in this church? Because just because you can doesn't mean that you should. What is God requiring of you in the season that you are currently in? Because in this season, I'm not trying to do what I want to do. In this season, I'm trying to do what God wants me to do. That's called common purpose. What does God want from me? Hallelujah. What does God want from me? It doesn't mean that I can't enjoy other things. I enjoy singing on the praise team. I don't sing on the praise team. I stand in my seat and sing. Now, can I sing? Can I move around with the praise team? Yes, doesn't mean I should. My assignment is to preach the word of God. My assignment is to pastor the church. I can do other things. I am a musician, but I'm not going to jump on the drums and say, Chauncey, get off the drum and let me play. Because that's not, even though I can, I'm gifted to, that's not my assignment. And to stay in alignment with God means that I have to first know what God wants from me. Hallelujah. What does God want from you? Watch this in verse 15. If the whole body were an eye, where would be the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where would be the smelling? Verse number 18, it says, "But now God has set the members, each one of them," watch this, "in the body just as he pleased." Because he's the head of the body. I need everyone to shout it, because sometimes we it's not that we don't know, but sometimes we forget. Shout it for you. God is the head of the body. Say it with me. Pastor is not the head of the body. God is the head of the body. Because listen, the body isn't just Restoration Church. Pastor is the pastor of one church, but the one church is not the body. The one church is a member of the body, but it is not the body. God is the head of the body, and so therefore he fashions the body as it pleases him. Everybody lift your left hand. Drop your left hand. Now lift your right hand. What told your hand to do that? Your head. Your head is in control of the members of your body. Now you did not, nobody in this room had to have a conversation with your hand to tell your hand to be lifted. Now I'm going to tell you to lift your hand now. When pastors say lift, make sure you lift your hand. I don't care how tired you are. I don't care what you've done today. I don't care where you've been. When I give the signal, you lift your hand. Come on and lift your hand. Come on, play something. Encourage my hand to lift. Lift your hand when I say lift your hand. You have eaten enough today. Nobody has a conversation like that. The hand just lifts. Why? Because the head wills it. Everyone say God is the head of the body. Then how come he has to fight with the members of his body? Why does God have to persuade you to serve? Oh, y'all got quiet. Let me try this side. Why do you need persuading to serve when you're not the head? You are a member of the body. Our job is to do what he wants us to do. So what? I'm not going to serve. Why are you a rebellious member of the body? Now here's the thing. When something don't work, it'll soon be cut off. Come on, somebody. If something happens to your leg and it stops working, eventually the blood stops flowing to it and it starts turning a different color. And then we got to cut it off so it doesn't affect the rest of the body. Sometimes people have to leave the church so it doesn't affect the rest of the body. Oh, y'all not talking to me. This is why there are times that I might cry when somebody leaves, but I'll never invite them back. Because there are some people who mess up the unity of the body of Christ. And there are some things more important than my feelings. It's called his will. Amen. They're not saying amen tonight, prophet. But I'm telling you what I know. Sometimes you have to say goodbye to people that you miss. Because it's not about your feelings. It's about his will. And if it's about his will, I love the body more than I love my emotions. So if I have to miss you to make him happy, I'd rather miss you than disobey God. Because he's the head of the body. And he does what pleases him. Who's the head of the body? So, but now God has set the members, each one of them, in the body as it pleased him. Verse number 19. And if they all were one member, where would the body be? If everybody was a seer, who's the worker? The only way this church functions, and I'm going to use this church, but really I'm talking about the body. The only way this church functions is if everybody takes a piece. Before you got here tonight, somebody had to clean. Everybody can't be the singer. Everybody can't be the usher. Somebody has to make sure the building is ready. It's warm in here tonight. Somebody had to turn the heat on. Somebody had to make sure that the parking lot was okay. Someone had to make sure the lights were on. Somebody had to sing tonight. Somebody had to rehearse. Somebody had to study. There are things already in place for Sunday because people are doing stuff behind the scenes that we don't see. We don't come to church on Sunday and things just magically happen. There's a lot of preparation. There's study time. There's rehearsal time. There's meetings going on all throughout the week to prepare for our experience on Sunday. Things happen behind the scenes. But if everyone's doing the same job, how can we function? Which means, hallelujah, I have to be okay with you being different from me. I need you to point to somebody and say, I'm okay with you. I'm okay with you. Whatever your... I'm not okay with you not serving, but I'm okay with you serving differently from me. No. Let's say that again. I'm not going to be okay with you not serving because then you're procrastinating and you're not doing what God's called you to do. Doing nothing is not an option. But if you do something different from me, I'm okay. I can accept that you're different from me, but I will never accept you doing nothing is what God wants you to do. Because doing nothing risks everything. Verse number 20. I'm going somewhere tonight. But now indeed there are many members, yet one body. Everyone say many members, but one. Many members, but that means I got to be submitted to the body. I must understand that I am a member and not the body. I am a member and not the body. I know this is hurting our flesh tonight, but it's good. That's what alignment is about. I am a member. I am not the body. Verse number 21, watch this. The eye cannot say, this is what I love right here. Look at this. And the eye cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Nor again the head to the feet, I have no need of you. Verse 22. Much rather, those members of the body which seemeth to be the weaker are necessary. The church, and this is not just a restoration church problem. This is a body of Christ problem. We have placed so much necessity on what comes from the pulpit that we have almost taken the power from the pew. I want pastor to lay hands on me. But when we are a healthy church, I want anyone who's filled with the Holy Ghost to lay hands on me. I mean, anyone who has the Holy Ghost living on the inside of them. Pastor don't have more power than somebody filled with the Holy Ghost. Sometimes it's based on the obedience of the person and not because they are less spiritual than I. Amen, somebody. Amen. God could use anybody to speak into your life. And I need to tell you this too. Sometimes the things that God speaks to us are not always new. Sometimes it's a reminder. And a reminder can be just as powerful as hearing it for the first time. Have you ever heard a scripture that you haven't heard in a long time, but it came to you at the right second? And so sometimes what we think is less important, the Bible said what seems to be weaker is still necessary. I need you to point to somebody and say it with a serious tone. Say, you are necessary. Tell them on the other side. Say, you are necessary. Because the head can't go where the feet don't take them. Lose your big toe. You don't know what you need until you don't have it. Lose your thumb and you will miss it. Every day you use your thumb and you don't even know how important it is until you don't have it. And then sometimes we come into church and let something be missing and then everybody got something to say. Because absence makes us see what's necessary. This is why it's the culture of our church to appreciate everything. Because I don't want to have to stand over your grave to say thank you. I don't want to have to visit you in hospital to see how necessary you are. I've had people in this church tell me, Pastor, you ain't got to keep saying thank you. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. Every week, I'm going to say thank you to everyone who I see serving. Thank you for serving. Why? Because you are necessary. And people will come to the pastor all day and say, preach, pastor, you did an amazing job. But they don't know that the microphone, somebody got to turn it on. The people on the live stream don't hear me unless Josiah is sitting at the camera, holding the camera. They can't get the gospel without somebody on the camera. So no matter how much I'm preaching, I need other people to make what I do work. So everyone say, everybody's necessary. Everybody is necessary. While I'm in Philadelphia today, somebody had to go to the hospital. I'm going to pray over somebody because pastor wasn't there. Everybody is necessary. And oftentimes we lift up what we see and put down what we do not see. Amen. You don't see my feet. You don't see my actual toes, but I need you to know my feet are carrying me all day. You don't see them. You see the shoes. But every single toe under your shoe is doing something. Every single finger you got has a purpose. Every part of your body, you cannot see your kidney, but you'll know if you don't have it. Amen. You cannot see your heart, but let it stop. So the things that cannot be seen are just as necessary. Go to verse 25. Go up to verse 25. Verse 30, 23. That there should be no number. Go to 23. I'll go up to 25. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, on those we bestow great honor, and our unpresentable parts have greater modesty. But our presentable parts have no need. For God composed the body, having given greater honor to the part which lacks it. Which means God takes great honor in the things that we do not see. Why? Look at this, verse 25. That there should be no schism. That word schism means division. There should be no division in the body, but that the members should all have the same care for one another. I would that we would get to a place that we would not only be responsible for us, but we would be responsible for each other. That when we see something wilding out on Facebook, that we don't take a screenshot and send it to people that can't do nothing about it. Oh, y'all got quiet. Y'all must be guilty. Amen. When was the last time you saw something on Facebook and addressed that person? Because here's what the Bible says in Matthew 18. If you see something, you're not supposed to come to your pastor first. Pastor, I just thought I'd send you this so you can see it. My first question won't be, did you talk to them? Because as being their fellow brother or fellow sister, they might receive correction from you first. If you come to me, sometimes it can hurt people to hear that you've gone to the pastor and bypassed all the steps. But you could have just said, hey, I saw something on Facebook. You all right? I saw you wilding out. You okay? You want to talk? You got someone to talk to? That's a real conversation. And people might be like, well, Pastor, I'm not trying to get nobody's business. My brother and sister is my business. Are my business, whatever. I need to look at somebody and say, you're my business. No. Hold on. Because we have such a strong none of your business spirit amongst us as believers. But I need you to break that spirit off somebody, look at them and say, you are my business. I didn't say you're my gossip. I said you're my business. I didn't say I'm going to talk about you. I'd rather talk to you. You are not my subject for gossip. You are my business. And as my business, I have a requirement to pray for you. I have a requirement to cover you, which means I'm not going to screenshot it and send it to somebody else. I'm going to keep it to myself and pray for you first. The moment you joined my church, you became my business. The moment I learned your name, the moment we got friends on Facebook, you became my business. You better believe I'm looking at your Facebook. I'm holding you accountable, baby, and I want you to hold me accountable. Oh, y'all quiet. I don't care. I'm telling you what I believe. Amen. And when I see something, I'm not talking about past. I'm talking about as a fellow believer. When I see something that takes your witness, it's my responsibility to call you directly and say, you all right? That's not indicative of a Christ-like relationship. Amen, somebody? Plenty of times I've called somebody up and said, take that post down. That's not Christ-like. That's not God. Elder Javante, I'm going to testify about you. I don't care. It's about me, really. It's not about him. How many of y'all know that I love wrestling? I love wrestling. Right? If you look at my Instagram stories, I post wrestling stuff all the time. All the time. Just I see the wrestling, or it's about my hometown in England, just all kinds of landscapes. I love landscapes, all kinds of stuff. So I post all kinds of stuff. I posted something about wrestling recently, I think a week and a half ago. I posted these two women who are wrestling, and I posted this clip of them wrestling. Jade Cargill just came from AEW. She's in WWE. I'm excited. And I posted it, and she did this big slam, right? And I love that move. It's a great move. So I posted on Instagram stories. Elder Javante messaged me. He said, Pastor, did you watch the clip you posted? I said, yeah. It's whatever, right? So I watched it again. He said, did you listen to it? Now, I didn't know that when she slammed the woman, she was like, get your big A up. Oh, no. I did not hear it. I thought it was just a body slam. I didn't hear it. I texted back and said, thank you, Elder. That's what I expect you to do. Making sure your pastor, nobody talks about your pastor, because you got to shun the very appearance of evil. Y'all didn't hear what I said. What I'm not going to do is be like, God knows my heart, and it's my Facebook, it's my Instagram. I do whatever I want to do. No, I represent something bigger than me. I don't want the kingdom to be tainted in any way. So the body slam is not that important. I deleted it immediately. Some things people post and they didn't do it on purpose. Sometimes they do it on purpose. Other times they don't. But the elder corrected his pastor, and I'm humble enough to receive it because I don't want to ever have my witness to be tainted either. Can people call you and correct you about your social media? Because the question becomes, what's more important? What you want to do or your witness that you're wearing in your spirit? You say you are Christ-like. You say you are a believer. That means I got to be open to correction when I do something that's un-Christ-like. And it's not just social media. If I see you acting with an attitude in church, I should be able to come up to you and say, get your world together. Put a smile on your face. Why are you miserable? You in church. Where's your Christ-like demeanor? Why are you looking mean? Amen. I just say whatever I want to say. Then go and sit in the back somewhere because we don't need it today. We got souls coming to church today. I don't need you to be, nobody sit around you with an attitude. So go and sit in the back or get back in your car and go home. Watch the live stream. Because I cannot have you in the house tainting your witness. I'm not talking about those who are trying. I'm talking about those that don't care. But that's the kind of church we got to have, that we so care for each other that I'm not going, for the sake of not bothering you, I'm going to allow division in the church. Amen, somebody. I need you to point to somebody. I don't point to nobody with your last name. Point to somebody and say, you can correct me. Amen. Tell somebody that's on the other side. Say, you can correct me. I don't point to a leader either. Point to a fellow brother or sister, because it's not just about ranks. No, anybody can correct me. If we're going to be true to scripture, as a pastor, I shouldn't be like, well, who are you talking to? I'm a pastor. No, I'm a believer before I'm a pastor. Let me say that again. Leaders, we are believers before we are leaders. So if anything is going on that's unchristlike, you have the opportunity to come to me and get me back in alignment with God. Anybody in this house want to be in alignment with God? I mean, just anybody. Which means I've got to be willing to take rebuke. Where you been? You only showing up once a month. Why? I don't feel like coming today. Well, stop doing that. Because if you stop coming, if you stop feeling going to work, you're not going to have a job. Stop doing that to God and come to the house of the Lord. Amen. How come you're not reading your Bible? What's the last scripture you read? I'm not reading right now. Well, get back in your word. Amen. Some of us need tough love. Come on, somebody. Everything can't be, oh, why? No, sometimes you need a coach, not a comfort. Every now and then you need comfort, but every now and then you need a coach. Get your head back in the game. It's too important. Your destiny is too important for you to waste time. This is the year that God's calling you to do great things. Come back in alignment. And I'm not leaving without you. Come on, saints. I need you to look somebody behind you and say, I'm not leaving you behind. Amen. Amen. Y'all getting something out of this tonight? I'm sorry. I'm just rolling with God. Go to the scripture for me. So everyone shout alignment. Everyone shout assignment. Let me just quickly finish assignment. I told you last week, this is where I finished last week, that you should know your race, know your grace, and know your chase, right? I talked about knowing your grace means to stay in your lane, to know where God has called you to serve. Knowing your grace is knowing your gifts, knowing what he's called you to do. To know your chase is to know your audience, who God has called you to, because your voice is not assigned to everybody. Your voice is assigned to a certain people. So I finished last week talking about the fact that some of us are procrastinating, and the fact that he said to, remember in Matthew 25, he looked at the one who had one talent who buried it, and he said he called him wicked and lazy. That's what we stopped last week. He called him wicked and lazy. Why would he call him wicked and lazy? Because the one who had one talent intentionally buried it. It wasn't just he was struggling he intentionally buried it. And the truth be told, here it is in Matthew 25 and 26, but his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not gathered a scattered seed. Verse number 27, he says, so you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. My brothers and sisters, it is dangerous to bury what God gave you. Now I need you to catch this. Some of us don't know our gifts. Right? And that's okay. Everyone shout, I'm gifted. If you're in a process of learning what God has gifted you to do, that's a good thing. It is dangerous to know it and intentionally bury it. I have too much fear not to do what God's called me to do when I know my assignment. What has God called you to do? And when you know it and say, I'm not doing it. I'm not is different from I can't. I'm not is defiant. I'm not as rebellious. And I'm not sounds like wickedness. He said, you're wicked and you're lazy. Now that seems like harsh language, but it is, because it's a harsh thing to bury talent that God has given you. And so you've got to know this is the year where you have to fulfill your assignment. All right, I want you to take 30 seconds. I'm not going to let you have any longer than 30 seconds. Everyone say 30 seconds. I want you to turn to somebody and I want you to tell them what you believe your assignment is. One assignment. Now, everyone has multiple assignments. Everyone has multiple assignments. All right? But one thing you know God has called you to do. Now, listen to me. Before you do it, anyone in this room that says, Pastor, I don't know, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say, I don't know. Because I don't know is a safe answer too. Remember, the person who doesn't know their assignment isn't walking in sin. It's the person who knows it and won't do it. So if you sincerely don't know, I want you to look at your neighbor and say, I don't know. I'm trying to figure that out. That's an acceptable answer. But I will take next 30 seconds and tell somebody, 15 seconds for one person and 15 seconds for the next person. Talk to somebody and tell them what you believe your assignment is. Right now, go. Everybody do it right now. What is your assignment? What are you gifted to do? What are you called to do? 15 seconds. Those on social media, write it in the comment section. I'm looking at it right now. All right, that's 15 seconds. Turn to the other person. Y'all, the person respond now. Good. This is beautiful. Beautiful. Sometimes you got to just say it out of your mouth. All right. Clap your hands and give God praise all over the room. I see you. Those of you who have mentioned on social media, I see you, Artricia. I see you, Lori. Those who have mentioned your assignments online. Now here it is. For those of you who don't know your assignment, I want you to contact me because we have a spiritual gift survey that I can give you that you can at least start going in the right direction. Okay? Serve where you are needed until you can serve where you're... Serve where you're gifted until you can serve where you're. One more time. Serve where you're needed until you can serve where you're. Serve where you're gifted until you can serve where you're. One more time for those writing it down. Serve where you're needed until you can serve where you're. Serve where you're until you can serve where you're. That means everybody has a place. If you do not know your calling, work in your gifting. These are the things that I'm good at. It's not my calling yet. I don't know my calling, but listen, I'm good at administration. I can count. I can do something. And if you don't know your gifting, serve where you're needed. Hey, Deacon and Trainer Chelsea, where is there a need in the church? Show me where the need is. I want to do this. And Chelsea says to you, well, we need people out in the parking lot. I don't know what that means. Tell me what it means. I don't want you to go outside. I want you to greet people as they come in and lead them to their parking spot. And in that moment, hallelujah. First of all, the parking is a whole ministry, just so y'all know. That just hit my spirit. Parking ministry is a ministry. Amen, Deacon. I hear you. It's a whole ministry out there. Because they are the first preachers. When somebody pulls up in the parking lot, you don't know what happened on the way to church. And when they pull up in the parking lot and they see a deacon with a smiling face, welcome to Restoration Church. That's the first preacher long before they get to the pastor. It's a whole ministry. And while you're out there serving as a parking attendant and it's cold outside, but you wanted to serve where you're needed, God is going to download to you what your gift is. But God will never give it to you while you're doing nothing. It's better for you to do the wrong thing than do nothing at all. God will speak to you about where you're supposed to be, but he wants to see your hands working. The Bible says, work while it is day, for the night's coming where no man can work. So you got to serve somewhere. So serve where you need it until you can serve where you're gifted. Serve where you're gifted until you can serve where you are called. Now, for those of you who were able to articulate your assignment, your question then becomes, Lord, how do I fulfill my assignment this year? How do I walk in the totality of my assignment this year? How can I make it happen? Who do I need to be connected to? Amen. Who can help me get to where I need to get to? Because I have an assignment to do. Somebody came to me last week because I mentioned that this year I'm going to be writing my second book. Someone came to me last week and said, Pastor, show me what you know about writing books. I said, I don't know much. I said, you know more than me. Show me what you know. Why? Because being connected to somebody who's done it before will help you get to where you need to be. So you have to know. So even if you're not sure about your assignment, you need to ask the Lord, how do I fulfill my assignment that you've given me this year? because I don't want to get to the end of 2024 and talk about fulfilling my assignment like I did at the end of 2023. Amen, somebody? So everyone say assignment. All right, the rest of my time tonight, I have to talk about assessment. Everybody shout assessment. Now, assessment is the evaluation or estimation of the nature, the quality, or ability of someone or something. Again, the evaluation, glory to God, we'll talk about evaluating in a minute. The evaluation or estimation of the nature, the quality, or the ability of someone or something. I want you to know this, that assessment is very biblical. When you talk about assessing something, go with me to Psalm 139, verse 1. When you talk about assessing something, and I want you to write some of these words down because these words are really connected to the word assessment. When you talk about assessing something, you are talking about it means to judge, to prune, correct, or to look deeply into something. To judge, to prune, to correct, or to look deeply into something. To judge. Now, I want to share this with you, that usually when you talk about judging, it comes off in a negative connotation, right? Yeah. Don't judge me. Only God could judge me. But do you know the Bible talks about righteous judgment? To judge something is not a negative term. To judge something basically means to examine it. Amen. So in that context, we should be judgmental. Hey, everyone say it. Say, I'm judgmental. We're called to judge. We're called to examine. But examine, the reason why we sometimes made that a negative connotation is because we examine everything else but ourselves. Judgment starts at home. And I'm able to judge others more correctly and judge them according to the word of God if judgment starts with me first. You should never judge somebody when you have not judged yourself. So judgment starts with me. To judge, to assess something is to judge, prune, correct, or look deeply into something. Watch this. Psalms 139. Oh, I love this scripture. This scripture will make me emotional in about 5 seconds. Look what David said. He said, "O Lord, you have searched me and have known me." Go to the last verse if you can, Elder. Last verse if you can. I'll go to the verse before that, verse 23. "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties." Now, verse 1 said, "You have searched me." Past tense. The last two verses said, "Search me." It's almost backwards. Because the chapter should start with saying, "Lord, please search me and know me." And the end of it should say, "Well, Lord, you have searched me and you have known me." Why is it that the beginning of the chapter starts in the past tense? "Lord, you have searched me and you have known me." And by the end of the chapter, he says, "Search me and know me." It's because David understands that before you ask him, God already knows you. When you ask God to search you, it's not because he doesn't already know you. It is that you are giving him permission to reveal to you what he already knows about you. One more time. To ask God to search you is for him to reveal to you what he already knows about you. When you ask him to search you, it's not because he doesn't know. "You have searched me and you have known me." You know my heart. Because you made me. You created me. So I can't hide anything from God. Which is why we talk to people more than we pray. Because you can't lie to him. So we'll sit with a counselor and not come to the altar. We'll talk to the pastor and talk to leaders because we can control what they know. But we don't go to God in prayer because we already know he knows everything. "How you doing?" "I'm blessed and highly favored." "Child, please." Because then we don't have no prayer life. Because you know you can't come to God like, "I'm blessed and highly favored." "I know where you were last night, son. I know what's in your wallet, daughter. I know what's in your phone. I know where you've been and I know what you've done. And I hope you hear my heart when I say this. I have learned, Hatoshamama. I have learned that for God to know me is a blessing and not a curse. I'm telling you the truth. I have learned that when I come to the altar, I am at my most naked. I am at my most bare. I don't have to sit with God as I sit with a counselor and explain all of my life to him because he already knows. So I'm already starting at an advantage because he already knows me. So we can get to miracle because he already knows the mess. Hallelujah. Shout to somebody, say, I'm glad he knows me. And here's the thing. The devil will use that to make you feel condemned. Right? So we don't come to God because he already knows. Now, because God knows, does not mean that we don't have a responsibility to confess. Because confession is not revealing it to God. Confession is acknowledging it. I have a problem. I have an issue. Lord, here I am in my purest form. I cannot lie to you. And I can come to God with my purest form and say, you already know me. These people don't really know me. My mama don't really know me. My siblings don't really know me. Turn to somebody and say, I love you, but you don't know me. You know what I tell you. You know what I give you. But as a part of me, you don't want to know. Y'all got quiet, but I know y'all. I know I'm telling the truth. Even the quiet people, I know I'm telling the truth. There's a part of me that you don't want to know. There's mistakes I've made that you don't want to know. There's failures and errors of my past that I can never share with anybody. I got to take it to the grave. But thanks be unto God. That not only does he know, he don't tell nobody my business. One Sunday, you want to just run around the church that God kept it to himself. Because he has prophets he could have revealed it to. But there are some things that God will make sure never gets out. Amen. Somebody just lift your hand and say, God, thank you for being a safe place. Oh yeah, I got some people that are safe place, but I also got some people that can't take all of my stuff. Even the people that know my secrets, you know a measure of it. Nobody knows everything. But thank God the one that knows everything kept it to himself. In fact, he didn't just keep it to himself. He put it on the grave and died for it. Excuse me, on the cross and died for it. So search me and know me. He said, you have searched me. You know me already. You know me already. You know my uprising. You know my down city. You know exactly where I am. You know who I am. You know where I've been. You know who I've been with. You know what I've done. And so he gets to the end of the chapter. Holy Ghost, help me today. He gets to the end of the chapter and he says, since you already know, I give you permission to search me. I know my heart. It's assessment. Look past my degrees. Look past my collar. Look past my assignment. Look past the things that impress everybody else. Because there are people that love me because of what I do for them. Look past that. There are people who love me because I bless them. Look past that. Look past my money or lack of. Look past my car and my home. Look past my job. Look past my last name. Look past all the things that stroke my ego. Look past my arrogance, because every one of us have a measure where we think that we're so cool. Look past all of that. He said, search me, oh God, and know my heart. Don't know my words. Listen, if God don't know my heart, he ceases to be God. I know God to look into the contents and the intent of my heart. This is why David said in Psalm 51, he said, create in me what kind of heart? A clean heart. Because it takes a humble person to admit our hearts are dirty. Saints of God, hear me today. I know it's going to be tough because assessment is tough. assessment stuff. We are experts, James. We're experts, Deacon Leroy, at pointing to everybody else. I'm pointing out their faults and calling out their errors and their ways. But we are quiet. We are loud with everybody else's mistakes, but quiet with ours. We whisper ours. We can lay hands on everybody else in the name of Jesus. And anxiety be gone, and fear be gone, and sin, that spirit of lust, be gone. What about your spirit of lust? How come you're so quiet about yours? Because nobody has ever taken a screenshot and sent anybody else their own mistake. Have you ever, you haven't sent somebody something and said, have you seen where I was last night? No, we do it to everybody else. We talk about everybody else. But when was the last time you put yourself on it? Did you hear the words that came out of my mouth last night? I'm tripping. No, we do it to everybody else. Did you see me falling over last night, drunk out of my mind? No, we do it to everybody else. But this is the season God said, search me. This time, put yourself on the altar. Lay hands on yourself. Because if we get better as individuals, the church will be more healthy if I focus more on me than I do the person I'm sitting next to. Search me, oh God, and know my heart. Try me. Try me means sometimes God has to put you in a season of conflict. Sometimes he got to get you by yourself to try you. Because if he's going to heal you, he's got to get in those hidden places. Oh, man, no, Shanda Bahaya. He's got to get in them places that you ain't told nobody about. So trying you will never happen on a Sunday while you're dancing and having a praise break. He will never try you in those moments. He'll support you, but he won't try you. It's got to come from conflict. It's got to come when you are at your highest point of anger. Then he'll try you and say, forgive. Everyone say, let him try you. This week. Yes, I hear you. He's got to try you during times of conflict. You'll hear your name being talked about and you know exactly what to do to say it back. Have you ever practiced your response? Y'all not talking to me. Amen. You ever knew exactly what to say? And you was driving home saying, when I get home, I'm going to say this, 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 this. When I see her at church, I'm going to walk up right to her and say, knew exactly what to say. And then you got up for that person and God said, relax. Have you ever wrote the post? Delete, 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 delete. There's been sometimes I've written a post and I said, and the Lord said, delete it. I said, all right, but I'm going to screenshot it though. Amen. Y'all not talking to me. Amen. I done screenshot it, put it in a folder just in case I want to gratify. And this is what I was going to say. Oh, you. Just in case my flesh rises up later, I want to remember every word. Y'all not talking to me. I'm telling you what I've done. Amen. That screenshot might be terrible. At least I didn't post it though. Amen. Assessment is hard. Self-reflection can be difficult. Because it calls you to put yourself on the altar. I'm okay with everything being on the altar but me. I'm okay with laying hands on the altar. I'm okay with blessing everyone on the altar, but don't put me on the altar. Because the hardest thing to fix is me. God can give you a new car, new house. He can give you money, land, relationships, all that. The hardest thing to fix on me is me. My biggest struggle is my own mind. My biggest struggle is my body. My biggest struggle is my heart. My biggest struggle is me. He can fix everything around me, but what does he do with me? So I need before God can do it, I have to admit not only that I have a problem, I have to admit that I am the problem. I feel a wind blowing through this room right now. Can I say that one more time? Say it one more time. I don't only need to admit that I have a problem. I need to admit that I am the problem. Hey, glory be to God. And so he says, do this. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxieties. Verse 24, last verse. And see if there be any wicked way. Where is it? Where is it? It's in me. So I need to get to a place. Hallelujah. Spiritual growth says I stop blaming everybody around me for my own behavior. I need to stop pointing to everybody else about stuff that I'm doing. Nobody's responsible for me but me. Adam said, Lord, this woman you gave me. Nah, bro. You're responsible for you. Eve ate, you didn't have to. He gave you the command. Who did God hold responsible? Adam. He did not hold Eve responsible. He held Adam responsible because he gave the leader. He gave you the command. Now you're like, oh, this woman. You didn't say this woman when you were sleeping with her. You didn't say this woman, you were skipping around Eden, just eating all the fruit you want to eat. But as soon as there's a problem, we point whenever we don't want to be guilty. It's what we do. So see if there's any wicked way in me and lead me to the way everlasting. This is the last thing I want to share with you. Thank you. This is the last thing I want to share with you. Assessment should always end in encouragement and support. Yeah. Assessment should always end in encouragement and support. You should never be in a place, hallelujah, when you're assessing yourself, you should never be in a place that leads to condemnation. If I don't put this on the end of this teaching, I would not be doing the gospel right. You need to know that there is a remedy. You need to know that sin has been paid for. You have to know that there is a way out and there is a way through. Self-assessment should never end in condemnation. It should end in encouragement. Write some of these scriptures down. This is the four scriptures I'm going to give you. And then we're going to be gone. If you put up media elder, if you could put up Jeremiah 29 and 11, but write these four scriptures down. Hebrews 10 and 24. Proverbs 25 and 11. Philippians 4 and 13. And the one that I'm getting ready to read, Jeremiah 29 and 11. Those are the four scriptures, but I'll finish with this one. Jeremiah said, for I know the thoughts. Well, Jeremiah's writing, but it's God speaking. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. What is he saying? He says, as you are assessing yourself, hallelujah. I said this in Aberdeen on Tuesday, I say it tonight. As you are assessing yourself, it's important, and some of us, let me say this before I say that. Some of us have to unlearn some things that we've been taught. Yes. I'm getting ready to put something on you, but you're not going to be able to receive it unless you unlearn some things. Because what I was getting ready to tell you is that when God looks at you, he doesn't see you. But you cannot receive that unless you unlearn some things. You have to unlearn that God is looking at you. He looks at the blood of his son. When God sees you, he sees the righteousness of God. He sees you as the redeemed sons and daughters of God. He does not see you oftentimes the way that we see ourselves. We look at ourselves and we see failure. We look at ourselves and we see a mistake. We look at ourselves and we stack up all of our errors and all the things that we've done that should disqualify us from being with God. Good God Almighty. Which one is it? Which one is it? Help me, Holy Ghost. Help me, Holy Ghost. Put up 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. 2 Corinthians 13, verse 5. When God sees you, look at this, this last scripture. You ready? Last scripture. All right, I've read all night. I want y'all to read this last one. That's how we know it's the last one, because y'all gonna read it. All ready? Let's go. Examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. That's assessment, right? Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you? Read. Verse 6, last verse. But I trust what? I need you to tell somebody, say, you are not disqualified. Y'all do it right. I need you to find somebody who's filled with the Holy Ghost. Act like it's a Sunday. Tell somebody, you are not disqualified. He said, when you examine yourself, I want you to come to a realization about where you've been. I want you to come to a realization about all the things that you've been through and all the mistakes you've made. But when you get to the end of your self-assessment, remember this, you are not disqualified. You messed up, but you didn't disqualify yourself. You made many mistakes, but you did not disqualify yourself. You have walked in error of the scriptures, but you have not disqualified yourself. Paul said the examination is to see whether you are disqualified. But he said, I trust that you know this. Because Jesus Christ died for you. Hey, because his blood was shed for you. I hope you know this. You are not disqualified. So don't let self-assessment lead to condemnation. Don't let self-reflection lead you to think that you're disqualified by God. Every time you come into church, walk up with your head held high. Knowing that your behavior could never get you to him, but his blood did. I got news for you. You will probably make more mistakes than you think between now and Sunday. And yet you will not be disqualified. Because his blood didn't just pay for past mistakes. I feel like running, Zion, but I got to get out of here. His blood didn't just pay for past mistakes. His blood aren't just paying for your mistakes now. But his blood has already stepped into Friday, Saturday, and Sunday and made sure that nothing would disqualify you from the presence. What can separate us from the love of God? I need you to jump on your feet. I need you to wrap your arms around somebody and tell them nothing can separate you. Oh, come on. I need you to unlearn it. I need you to get it out of your spirit. I need you to remind yourself that you are the righteousness of God, that you are a child of God, and you are loved by him regardless of how you perform. You will never be disqualified. Hey. Oh, no, 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 no. I got to get out of here. Assessment should never lead to disqualification. Assessment is not to condemn you. It's to tell the truth. But here's the truth of the word of God too. Greater is he that is in you. Jump on your feet, everybody. I'm through. Clap your hands for Jesus, not for me. Come on. Give Jesus a great round of applause. If you know that you're not disqualified, somebody bless him. Bless him. Bless. We don't have to run tonight. Just clap your hands and give him a great God bless you. Come on, tell him, Lord, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. We thank you. That nothing can separate us from the love of God. And what do we say to these things? If God be for us. I wish I had a victorious church tonight. If God be for us, who can be against us? I am not disqualified. Hey. Yeah. Well, I could run this church tonight. I'm not disqualified. Tell me who can stand before us. When we go in Jesus' name. Oh, lift up your hands, everybody. Grab somebody's hand. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. Hey, I got to close before I run. Oh, yeah. Squeeze that hand and look at them and say, you're not disqualified. Oh, yeah. Yes, I'm talking to you who has a criminal record. You're not disqualified. I'm talking to you that's made more mistakes than you can count. You're not disqualified. I'm talking to you who made mistakes in your last church. You're not disqualified. In your last relationship, you're not disqualified. I'm talking to those of you who made mistakes just this week. It ain't even years ago. Some mistakes you made this week, God told me to tell you, you are not disqualified. Now, God, in the name of Jesus, we stand on the authority of your word tonight. We're not just here encouraging ourselves, but we stand on the power of your word tonight, which says that when we test ourselves and examine ourselves, it is not to the point of disqualification. For whom the Son has set free is free indeed. So now, God, I squeeze joy into my neighbor's hand. I squeeze peace into their hand. Lord, remind them tonight that you have never left them, nor have you forsaken them. Remind them tonight, God, that the kingdom of heaven is still open to them. Remind them tonight, God, that even through their mistakes and failures, you want to use them anyway. That not only are they not disqualified from the kingdom, but they are not disqualified from service. Lord, I pray, God, that they are reminded tonight that when you see us, you do not see our mistakes or our failures, but you see the blood of Jesus Christ. Thank you for your blood. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for the sacrifice that was made. We say thank you because with full price came full victory. We say thank you tonight. And every time we assess ourselves, we will not disqualify ourselves. Every time we assess ourselves, we will not walk away from our assignment. For whom the Son has set free, we declare is free indeed. And so, Father, may we walk out of here with our head held high, with our hearts filled with joy, knowing that you are with us. You will never leave us nor forsake us. We declare it now in Jesus' name. Everybody say amen. Give Jesus a great praise all over this room, church. Oh, come on, if you've been fed by God tonight, clap your hands and bless him. Somebody shout hallelujah. God bless you. Be seated. Let's give unto the Lord tonight. And then we're getting out of here. Hallelujah. May heaven bless you. Oh, I feel good tonight. Amen. Amen. Glory to God. God bless you. You're grateful for the word of God tonight. Hallelujah. Well, I'm leaving church happy tonight. Amen. Everyone that could join me with a $25 seed, get that in your hand if you can, please. Amen. A $25 seed. Let's sow into the kingdom tonight. Amen. Pastor, I don't have 25. That's okay. 24 works too. Amen. No, seriously. Get the best in your hand that you can. If you don't have 25 tonight, just get the best that you can. You already know that we don't force nobody or teach nobody to give what you don't have. Amen. But those of you who can, get a $25 seed in your hand and let's sow into the kingdom tonight. Danny's standing to my right, to your left. If you want to give electronically, come now with your card and see her. Let's serve tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Aisha's coming with her. If you want to give a tangible seed, you'll be able to do that in just a few moments. While you are preparing your giving, let me remind you that this Sunday's game day. That's our version of Super Bowl Sunday. And so everybody's going to be in their NFL gear this weekend. Amen. If you got your football jerseys, wear that. If you don't have jerseys, amen. Your football colors, amen. All the Commanders, make some noise. Amen. Amen. All right. Amen. All the Ravens fans, make some noise. Amen. Amen. You wearing your Oreos or color tonight, but she'll be in her purple on Sunday. Steelers, 2 or 3. I see you. Eagles, that's us all day. Seahawks. If y'all don't know, not by Minister Candace, she loves Jesus and she loves Seahawks. Amen. Amen. What other team am I missing? Oh, God, not the Cowboys. Amen, the Cowboys. Is that you, Chris? Cowboys? Cowboys? What other team is out here? 49ers? Who got the 49ers? 49ers? All right. That's San Francisco 49ers. Who else? Team Jehovah. Amen. Who's on no team? Raise your hand if you're on no team. Team no team. Oh, that's the majority of y'all. Amen. Amen. So, Deacon Leroy, we're just going to take all of them into Eagles. Amen. Glory to God. Amen. So bring your NFL gear out this Sunday. Let's have a great time. Invite someone to church this Sunday. Amen. We are growing on a weekly basis, saints. Aren't you glad about it? I posted it on the other day because it almost brought tears. We were full on Sunday without no special service. Just, I mean, they had to put out extra chairs. You want to give God praise for a growing church. Amen. Jesus wants a full house. It's even scriptural. He wants a full house. The Bible said that when they wouldn't, those that were invited to the table wouldn't come. He said, go out into the byways and highways and compel them to come that my house may be full. Amen. He wants a full house. So everyone, I want you to point to somebody and say, bring somebody with you on Sunday. Amen. Bring somebody with you on Sunday. Let's pack this house out. I have no problem. If we keep being full each week, we're going to pay for extra chairs. Amen. And get in here because I want to pack this house out from the front. I want chairs all the way to the back wall. I said all the way to the back wall. Amen. And I want to be full enough that we can start looking for our new place because we do have a new place coming. Amen, somebody. Amen. With a bigger parking lot. Y'all not talking to me. Amen. Yes, our own parking lot. Amen. So I'm excited about what the Lord is going to do. Amen. So keep on giving, keep sowing, keep coming, keep bringing people to the church. Amen. I'm talking about the new building, but you know that's not our why. Amen. We need a new building, but it's not our why. Amen. Our why is that people might be saved and come to know who Jesus is. And I'm excited about that. Amen. Glory to God. Can you stand to your feet all over this room? We're ready to go home. The vision of our house is what? To be a safe place for broken people, restoring each person with the love of Christ. How are we going to do it? One city at a time. Amen. We have some visitors in the room. Clap your hands for them tonight. Thank you so much for coming. God bless you. I hope you've been blessed tonight. Amen. Thank you for joining us. And to all the partners of our church, I love you so much. You love your pastor? I love you so much. Join us. Thank you. I wanted to say thank you, Lord, for reminding me. I want to say thank you to everybody who prayed for me. I wasn't feeling well on Sunday. And I understand that after I walked out that everybody started praying for me. Thank you so much. Those who text me and just checked up on me. Amen. I'm doing 100% better now. Amen. So thank you so much for your prayers. And didn't the Lord bless us on Sunday? Lord. Amen. I don't know what it is, but even though I wasn't feeling well all day, somehow when I get in the pulpit, the Lord will just give me supernatural strength. And so I'm just so grateful for all the prayers of the saints. We look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday. Lift your hands. I'm going to pray over the offering and pray for the close of service at the same time. If I don't get to hug you, know that I love you very much. I look forward to seeing you this coming Sunday. But I am asking everybody before you leave to at least hug three people that didn't come with you. Amen. And serve by hugging them and loving them in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, God, we thank you for this moment. Thank you for the word of God tonight. Thank you for what you have shared with us. I pray, God, that the words that we've written down will go deep down in our spirit. Let it be inscribed upon our hearts tonight, that we may be remembered that you are with us. Thank you for this year's theme of alignment, assignment, and assessment. I pray, God, as we go through this year, that, God, you will repeat the cycle over and over again, that we may continue to stay in alignment with you, to walk in our assignment, and to continually assess who we are in you. And, Father, we know this, that even in examining ourselves, we are not disqualified. Bless this offering tonight, God, as even as we sow tonight. May it go to the expansion of your kingdom. And we shall give your name glory, honor, and praise. Until we meet again, keep us in the center of your will. Keep us connected one to another until we see each other again. Now may the saving grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, the faithful fellowship and sweet communion of the Holy Spirit Comforter, rest, remain, and abide with us all, now and forevermore, in Jesus' name. Everyone say amen. Would you come and touch the bucket with your phone, and that will be your dismissal today. I love you so much.